Let's go. Hello, everyone. I'm Aurélien David. This is how you can spell my name. I'm very happy to be here at Happy Days. And of course, I'm French, so I will try to do my best in English. In case you have some issues, don't hesitate to come see me after this talk. I work at Cap Collectif. We are what we call civic tech, startup in the open government domain. And of course, we use GraphQL. Just to give you an example of what we do, I don't know if you heard of Le Grand Débat, but you probably heard of the Yellow Jackets and a crisis. And in order to answer to this crisis, the French government they ordered us a website in which every citizen could add IDs and share its point of view with others. So we created this website, granddebat.fr. And it was for us the first time we launched a public GraphQL API. But let's go back to our subject. What's an API? An API is a contract. Okay, it's a contract with your users, the people that are going to use your API to fetch data. But this contract, you as an API maintainer, you want to evolve it. You want to add new features. You want to make things more clear. You want to be able to evolve this contract very fast. Like your technical teams, they don't want to wait like 1 year just to deliver a new feature in your API. And so for that, you need flexibility and freedom. But the problem is that at the same time, you have to maintain your contract. You don't want to break things for users, so you cannot modify responses, query parameters, and available features. Like you don't want to make this cute cat sad. So how can you do that? One way is to use version management. Okay, so you can add a version to your endpoint, for example, v1, v2, v3. And this solution works great because you have different versions, so you can do what you want in each version. But once you publish the version, you can't make any significant change to it. And for users, every time they want to upgrade, because it's cool to go to the next version, but it's a lot of work for us because at one time, they have a lot of things to do. And for me, when I was when I wanted to launch a public API, I was like, I'm not sure. It's real good. I don't know. It's the perfect design. It's not how I see my API. I don't want to say, okay, this is the perfect API. Use it, and 3 months later, I'm very sad of it because it doesn't work. Another solution to this problem is continuous evolution. Okay, so we are not going to release version, but we are we will only have one version of our API, but we are going to gradually add features and deprecate usage. Okay, we are going to say do not use this stuff anymore, but use the shiny new features instead, and it's so much closer to how I think and how I develop my API every day. I don't think of a perfect API model every year. It evolves little by little. But if you want to deprecate things, it means that if you want to get the flexibility and the speed back, you will have to remove these things at one point. So this is what we call a breaking change. Okay, we are going to break your API for existing users. So how do you choose a policy? How do you break your API? Like this guy. I look for what was online, and I saw that Facebook, they don't do breaking change. Okay, so they have a schema that is many years old, with hundreds of people working on it, and of course a lot of applications using it, and they never did a single breaking change. For me, it was like crazy. Maybe it's because they have amazing engineers, but I don't trust in myself to do that. And it's not their public, their API is not public, not their GraphQL API. So for me, it was like a little cheating, because when it's for internal usage, you can have some bad naming, some stuff everyone knows is bad, but we continue to use it just to avoid breaking change. At GitHub, they have a real public API. And so they choose this strategy to deprecate and remove the usages after 3 or 6 months. So they announce it, and you have the date of the removal with each deprecation. And I think it's a better compromise for a public API. And of course, once you want to do breaking change and continuous evolution, you will have to communicate about it. So for that, they used a changelog URL, they use a Twitter account, and they use a RSS. And they also choose to take a lot of care to the deprecation messages. Okay, they included every useful information. For example, why they do this change. Why they think it's better to do a breaking change than keep it that way. How to replace the current usage for you as a user, and when it will be no more usable. But what I recommend is not only to communicate about breaking changes, because if you do continuous evolution, what you want is your users to use the new stuff that you build. So you will have to communicate a lot about the new stuff to give them to encourage them to use the new things, and don't be like sad to have to change their current integration. Okay, you want your users to be happy to evolve their integrations. You want them to love change. But what you maybe are more interested of is how can I avoid breaking changes? I have no miracle method, sorry, but I will show you some preventions. Okay, the first one is how to design your schema to evolve well, like this Iron Man. Okay, you will start with one thing and it will grow over time. So how can I start well in order to make it grow? What you have to always keep in mind is it's always easier to add something than to edit something. Every time you add a new field and new types, you will not impact existing users with GraphQL. If you use REST, for example, if you add something to a payload, to an endpoint, every customer will get the new data. It's not the same with GraphQL, because the client is asking, so if you have new stuff and no one is asking for it, it will not impact them. So always remember that if you want to avoid a breaking change, always add a new field. Name things well. Okay, I know naming is the other thing, or one of the other things in computer science. But if from the start you try to be specific, it can save yourself later. For example, if you have an event for vote, maybe just don't call it event vote or vote event, but try to be more precise. Like we called it add vote contribution event. Always try to remember that if later you want to do a breaking change just to change the name, it gives no value to your users. Okay, they are just they are going to think, oh, they are bad at naming, no, I have to change. It's not giving them value, so avoid it at all costs. Do not hesitate to complexify your schema. We always have to think, will I use a scala or will I use a type? For example, how to represent a time range. I could add to my event type a field start time and a field end time. But if you want to have better evolution, it's probably easier to add a time key that is new label and that will reference a time range object with key in it. So it will be easier to evolve this time range or this event than to remove scala. Because every time you remove a scala, you do a breaking change. So try to limit scala usage to the minimum. So you might know the relay specification. It's a client for React, but they also provide a server specification that gives you a few hints on how to design your schema in order to make it work well with the client. But after 2 years of using Relay, we started to know that, in fact, it's also a great way to avoid breaking change in the future. The first specification is all your main business objects must implement Node. Okay, it's an interface that you have in your graph, and it will and you have to add a Node query to your query type, and this will allow you to fetch any object of your graph. And once you have that, you don't have to write a single query every time you want to fetch a new object. Okay, if I add a vote object or event object, I will not have to create an event query, a vote query. Okay, I will always use the Node query. So this can avoid some breaking change. The second one is a connection. Okay, so this is a pattern for how to page through a list. For example, instead of returning an array, I will return a connection object that will give my client the possibility to page. And what I recommend is, for list, always use connection. Because if at one point you think you can use an array because it's easier, you don't need to page, you don't need to know the number of elements inside, if 1 year later you need to page or you need to know the number of elements, you will have to do a breaking change. Okay, so always use connection. And the third specification is each mutation should have its own input on payload type. And once again, we could think that we could share a type. For example, to add an object and to update an object, we could use the same input object. Because it's the same data for creating and updating. But if 1 year later you cannot add a field on the create mutation, but you can add it on the update mutation, you will have to do a breaking change. So if you use every time a specific input and specific payload for each mutation, you prevent yourself from this problem. And one other thing you have to do when designing your schema is choosing between nullable and non-nullable. So it's well known that in GraphQL, if something is non-nullable, if you have an error, like it will remove like a lot of data. Like it will have the snowball effect. Because if there is an error, the result is not valid, so GraphQL has to remove everything that doesn't match the schema. So we might think maybe it's better to use nullable everywhere. You can do that, but I don't recommend to do it because it's annoying for your customers. Okay, they have to check if everything is they have to check that everything is not nullable every time. And most of the time, like you have use case like it doesn't make sense. Like a blog post without title doesn't make sense for me. Don't lose meaning in your schema, and for entities where it doesn't make sense, use non-nullable. But every time you think that there is a risk that these things could be nullable in the future, use nullable. Most of the time, you use non-nullable for scalars and nullable for relations between types. And last advice, train your team. At Shopify, they released a GraphQL tutorial, and at GitHub, they have a huge public API. And what we did in my team was reading all the change log, see all their mistakes, and trying not to do this. Second prevention, how to avoid accidental breaking change. Because it happens sometimes, you have a teammate, he don't know, he can't remove a field, and he will do a breaking change. But we can avoid that. With GraphQL, you have the ability to generate a .graphql file. Okay, it's a file that contains all your schema in plain text. So we generate this file, and we commit it every time. Okay, every time you do a commit, we check that the file is up to date. So this looks like this. I have a file in my repo. And, oh, a teammate just removed a part of our API that is public. And in our continuous integration, we have a GitHub action that will show on our schema that here there is a breaking change, okay? It's saying, removing a field is a breaking change. It's preferable to deprecate it. So if a CI fails, we can't merge a breaking change. Okay, so this is pretty cool. We actually stole the ID from GitHub, but they didn't open source it, so we developed it ourselves, and you can use it too. It's on GitHub, Cap Collective, GraphQL Doctor. Next prevention, how can we manage cases when we are not quite sure? Sometimes you don't know what you are doing. And it happens when, Tobias showed you, when you want to move some parts of the internal API to the public API, okay? You don't know when you can press the button, you don't know when you are quite sure to do it. And to handle this case, I will say it's normal. It's normal not to be sure. You must be transparent, because API design takes time. And if you want to have trust, you want your users to use it, and if no one complains, you know you choose a good design, okay? And of course, you can allow some mistakes. So how to do it? That's where the preview schema is introduced. It gives us the ability to provide new features in our API, but saying that we will not respect our breaking change policy in this schema. So use it, but at your own risk. But obviously, every time you put some features in the preview schema, you want it to go to the public schema without changing anything, right? And let's see some magic to finish. After we deprecated something, how do I know I can remove it safely? I want to know how often this field has been used. Like, are there people that are still using my fields? And I want to know who they are. So I can contact them and tell them, I'm going to remove this, so please make the change right now. And this is possible with GraphQL. There is no magic, but because the client say what he wants, you can take the queries, like analyze it, say, okay, my client is requiring the field consultations on the type query, and this other client is asking for the field title on the consultation type. And with this analysis, I can know the usage of my schema. I know that people are still using some fields if they are deprecated. So knowing that, knowing the usage of your schema will give you the trust in your continuous evolution. Because if no one is using your deprecated field anymore, you know that you can remove it safely. And this is, for me, like an amazing thing that GraphQL provides, because I know everything that my clients are using. And for example, at GitHub, they created a little bot on Slack that gives them this usage. It's asking the usage of the field name on the repository type on the public schema signed 5 days. And at Cap Collective, we generate custom messages for deprecations that are still used, and we send them directly to our clients like this. I want to thank Marc-André Giroux. Tobias already told you about him, but he's really amazing. Like, if you want to do public API, follow him on this website. That's all for me. Thank you.
Great talk. So, do we have any questions? Yes, I see a question.
Hi, thank you for that very thoughtful, very useful talk. My question is really from the user perspective. Imagine the very, very end user who has data over time, 10, 20 years of data. With a version, they can have in the data what version of the software was underlying the results that they have. When you have this kind of not version but continuous change, what context do you give to the user in case they need for an audit or something like that to understand all the historical data?
We don't have this kind of usage right now. I don't have an easy answer. So probably, if you have this kind of usage, it's better to use versioning. I don't think, because I showed you continuous evolution, don't think you should do it. In fact, Shopify, they started to add version management to their API. So if you are not quite sure you can do it, don't do it. It's just something GraphQL makes easier, but you can also use it with REST. It has nothing to do with GraphQL. For me, it's just that GraphQL makes it easier. I hope this answers your question.
Great, thanks. Any other questions? All right, so thanks once again. Excellent talk.